People sure do love their doodads. Their who's-its and what's-its and thingamabobs. They especially love thingamabobs made by other humans a long time ago. I mean, you probably don't have your own collection of artifacts, but you were probably dragged to at least one museum full of them as a kid. But over the centuries, our love of ancient artifacts and the ego boost that comes with owning them has led to a lot of forgeries. And those fakes sometimes fooled even experts for years. So let's just take a quick look at four famous forgeries and the scientific sleuthing that took them down. In 1933, curators at New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art unveiled three terracotta statues from an ancient Italian civilization called Etruria. The trio included one giant statue of an Etruscan warrior, one life-sized statue, and one giant head more than a meter tall. The museum had acquired them between 1915 and 1921, and was finally ready to show them off. Unlike other similar artifacts from the 6th century BCE, these were not only nearly complete, they also retained their bright paint jobs. Now, if that sounds too good to be true, some experts in the 1930s thought so too. Questions rolled in quickly. Did the taller warrior's legs seem out of proportion to its torso? Was there something strange about the paint? Someone even claimed that there were crushed up beer bottles in the clay, making it sparkle. Then in 1936, a rumor came in. An art dealer had visited Rome and heard stories about a small team of art forgers named Alfredo Adolfo Fioravanti and the Riccardi brothers. According to the gossip, they decided to grow their pottery repair business into art fraud and had created the Etruscan statue trio from scratch. The museum investigated the accusations briefly, but defended their new display. It's hard to say exactly why the Met's own experts dismissed the warnings, you know, besides nobody wanting to admit they were duped. And if the statues were real, they'd be an amazing opportunity to learn about Etruscan art and culture. But suspicions persisted for decades, and by the late 1950s, the Met decided it was time to take a second look. They started with the paint. Earlier that decade, a ceramic chemist named Theodore Schumann had figured out how the ancient Greeks managed to create a black glaze for their pottery without using black pigments. He found that first, the pottery would be covered with a mixture of water and ferric oxide. That's the stuff that makes rust red. Then it would be fired in a kiln. If there was lots of airflow, that ferric oxide glaze would turn out, you guessed it, red. But by adding damp wood to the fire and cutting off air to the kiln, you would end up baking your pottery in carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide and steam would then react with the glaze to turn red ferric oxide into ferrous oxide and magnetic iron oxide, both of which are black. And the Etruscans would have used this same technique. So, by 1958, the museum's technical team knew what to look for: iron and oxygen. Anything else was a red flag, or perhaps we should say, a black flag. 2 years later, an investigation found, drumroll please, manganese. Lots and lots of manganese. That was a huge nail in the Etruscan warrior's coffin, but there were a few more loose ends to tie up. For one, the sheer abundance of paint was pretty suspicious. The last time a piece of painted Etruscan pottery had been found, the paint washed off in the rain. So it ought to be pretty delicate stuff. Too delicate to have stuck around in such a state for those statues. Then there was the fact that other terracotta statues from the era had a lot of holes punched in them. This helped with airflow so that the clay would dry without cracking before firing. Meanwhile, the Met's warriors only had one vent hole each. And again, what was up with the weird proportions on the big guy? Well, the answers eventually rolled in, thanks to some old-fashioned sleuthing. Dietrich von Bottmeyer, an art historian and curator at the Met, dug into the paperwork, and he found that the art dealer who bought the warriors for the Met had previously dealt in other forgeries, which normally would have set off an investigation all on its own. And a bit more digging through diaries and letters connected that art dealer to Fioravanti and the Riccardi brothers, the same trio that the museum was warned about in 1936. Bottmeyer met with Fioravanti himself in early 1961, and Fioravanti explained the whole fraud. The crew built their statues from the ground up in an empty building, but due to the limited space, they started to run out of room, resulting in those weird proportions. They would also knock over the statues to break them into pieces, so they knew they didn't need to fire each statue as one single piece requiring way fewer vent holes. Fioravanti still had the thumb of one warrior that fit perfectly onto the statue's hand like a terracotta Cinderella's slipper. And if that alone couldn't seal the deal, the signed deposition certainly did. By 1961, the Met had to admit their mistake. The statues were the first fakes bought and displayed at the museum. It only took 28 years for them to figure it out. But that is not as bad as our next entry. Imagine you're just a really big fan of Sir Francis Drake, the English admiral who sailed around the globe in the late 1500s. All your friends know how big of a fan you are, and one day you tell them you have the most amazing news. A shopkeeper showed up at your office with the Elizabethan-era brass plate that officially commemorated Drake's arrival in California. Your friends, though, are not happy for you. Actually, they're acting really awkward. And if it's 1936, you might just be Professor Herbert E. Bolton, director of the Bancroft Library at UC Berkeley, a major Francis Drake fanboy and member of a California Historical Society that is notorious for its pranks. Bolton died fully believing that he had the real Drake plate. But 24 years later, in 1977, scientists came to a different conclusion, thanks to a careful chemical analysis of the plate and comparison to genuine 14th to 18th century brass. Brass is an alloy, a metal made by combining other metals. It's mainly a mix of zinc and copper, but 16th century alloy making was an imperfect process and would have introduced a bunch of other metals, like antimony, lead, nickel, even silver and gold. The analysis of Bolton's brass plate revealed a clean combo of 35% zinc and 65% copper, evenly mixed and mechanically rolled flat. Which meant that it was probably made in the early 1900s, not in Drake's day. But the question remained, who made this fake and why? In 2003, historians at UC Berkeley called out the most likely culprits. Five of Bolton's friends and fellow history buffs who took a practical joke a little too far. The idea for the bogus brass plate apparently started with G. Ezra Dane, who, along with Bolton, was a member of E. Clampus Vitus, the prank-prone California History Society, also known as the Clampers. Man, people back in the day. Doing their own thing. And while the Clampers' leaders could not sanction Dane's buffoonery, he found four friends to help him out. Like, try and imagine this pitch meeting where Dane's like, hey guys, wouldn't it be funny if we fashion a brass plate, chisel in the text that, like, the world encompassed by Sir Francis Drake, and then heat it over a fire to develop a realistic patina to resemble 1500s brass and hammer on it, and then cover it with dirt and ash and aging chemicals, and then dump it into a park near Drake's Bay where it's gonna realistically maybe wash ashore and be found by someone. Absolutely, Dane. That sounds like a great idea. We think it's somewhat likely that the forgers had planned to bring Bolton to the drop site so that he could stumble onto it and then it would be like fun and he'd be like, ah, we planted that there. But unfortunately for everybody, someone else got there first, a shop clerk, found the plate at the top of the ridge, kept it in his car for a few months, and then brought it to Bolton after noticing the inscribed date of 1579 and the name Drake. Yes, Bolton's Francis Drake fandom was that well known, and he believed this ruse so much that he bought it for $3,500, which is about $80,000 today. Now, in his defense, Francis Drake said that he had left a brass plate where he landed in California, so any proper Drake fan would want to find it and show it off. But had Bolton taken a moment and actually bothered to do any scientific tests to check its authenticity, he probably would have come across one very obvious sign that it was a fake. Because in fluorescent paint, the pranksters had written the society's initials, ECV, on the back of the plate. They wanted Bolton to figure it out. They just didn't want him to pay $80,000 for it. They tried to drop hints. In the years shortly after the discovery, Clamper spoofs like an obviously fake brass plate, a fake ad for a novelty brass company called Late the Brass Bottom, which I'm sure was funny back then. There was a booklet titled Ye Preposterous Book of Brass. Those may all have been attempts to nudge Bolton to take a second look at his prized possession, but apparently, None of that worked, and eventually it became too awkward to tell Bolton and every other historian he'd convinced that they'd all been tricked. Most of the forgers literally took the truth to their graves. Three of the four died in the 1940s, well before Bolton's death in 1953. But until the forgery was revealed, California took the plate so seriously that it was featured at the World's Fair of 1939. Decades later, a copy of it was even gifted to Queen Elizabeth II. The last man standing, Lawrence Knoll, told the story bit by bit until researchers finally put the pieces together almost 70 years after the whole thing started. However, the real breastplate might be out there somewhere. Maybe another Drake stan will someday dig it up. Or perhaps I should say a more brilliant Drake stan because of this ad. This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an online learning platform that helps you build real knowledge through lessons you will actually remember. And the reason they can do that is down to their innovative course designs. You'll grow your problem-solving and critical thinking skills, no memorization required. Their lessons and knowledge checks are fun in that scratch-your-brain-just-right kind of way. Plus, they offer daily encouragement to keep you engaged and on track so you can feel good about actually finishing what you started. Brilliant will help make learning part of your daily routine, and who doesn't want to get smarter all the time? To try Brilliant for free, visit brilliant.org/scishow, scan the QR code on screen, or click the link in the video description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Now, let us turn to the oldest artifact forgeries on this list, the story of which also involves a lot of digging. In the 1980s and 90s, a Japanese archaeologist named Shinichi Fujimura changed the way people thought about the ancient history of human life in Japan. He worked on more than 150 archaeological sites during his career, and was so good at finding artifacts, he eventually got the nickname Divine Hands. His first finds in 1981 included stone tools that dated to about 40,000 years old, around 10,000 years older than similar artifacts at the time. Then in the year 2000, Fujimura beat his own record by, like, a lot. He found tools more than 600,000 years old. His findings led to textbooks literally getting rewritten. The story of Stone Age Japan and the origins of Japanese people kept getting older and older. But behind the scenes, other archaeologists were expressing doubt about the age of the artifacts Fujimura was finding. They didn't have much proof, though. At the time, the main way that archaeologists were dating these stone tools was based on where they were buried in layers of volcanic ash. Basically, each time a volcano erupts, it creates a layer of ash with a unique chemical makeup, called a marker tephra. Geologists map out the history of eruptions in ash layers, and then, if archaeologists find something cool beneath a layer of ash, it has to be older than that eruption. But you can't exactly dig up artifacts a second time, so archaeologists didn't have a good way to double-check Fujimura's claims. Enter some intrepid reporters from Japan's third-largest daily newspaper. In September and October 2000, they placed hidden cameras at two of Fujimura's archaeological sites, and they caught him red-handed. The images showed him taking real stone tools from his personal collection and burying them under extremely old volcanic ash early in the morning so that he or his colleagues would dig them up the next day. Fujimura quickly confessed and apologized, but the front page news immediately set off a reevaluation of all of his work and the standards of Japanese archaeology at large. After all, that reliance on volcanic ash for artifact dating made it easy for Fujimura to commit fraud. It also didn't hurt that Japanese archaeology didn't have a system for peer review, relying instead on trust and reputation when people made history-changing claims. Meanwhile, towns and cities near major discoveries benefited from the limelight, through pride in their history and through tourism, so it was really hard to challenge Fujimura's work until those journalists and their hidden cameras finally caught him. Some folks chalked up his actions to the stress of maintaining his reputation and job during a really difficult period for Japan's economy. But when his lies were exposed, he spent some time hospitalized for his mental health, changed his name, and moved to a new town. But once the truth was out, the field took the time to put things right. An investigation of Fujimura's work concluded that all of the dig sites he had been involved with had been faked to some degree. His artifacts were removed from museums, and the archaeological nonprofit that he helped lead was disbanded. Textbooks were rewritten based on legitimate findings, and now the best evidence puts Japan's Paleolithic period at about 37,000 to 16,000 years ago. And in 2010, the Japanese Paleolithic Research Association, which formed in 2003, released a database of more than 10,000 Paleolithic sites to increase communication and transparency in the field. And they also recently released a version in English. The great power of science is that it is self-correcting, and the discovery of this paleontology hoax created space for new research to set the record straight. For our final forgery, we're looking at another time someone used real artifacts to tell a fake story, but instead of rocks, it's swords. That's cooler. Let's be honest. In 2024, 8 ancient Iranian swords were seized at the United Kingdom border because they weren't bound for a museum, but for the illicit antiquities market. Can you imagine carrying swords? I'm like, that's gonna put off some of the metal detectors. When people are willing to pay big money for the coolest, rarest collectibles, that gives forgers even more motivation to create realistic, wallet-tempting fakes. These 8 swords were especially interesting because they were made of both bronze and iron. Given their age, they would be a physical representation of Iran's transition from the Bronze Age to the Iron Age. In other words, like the moment when people finally figured out how to smelt iron ore to make steel and started switching to making things like swords out of a stronger alloy. If you're gonna find an artifact from that transition anywhere, it would come from ancient Iran. 3,000 years ago, it was the place to be for innovation in metalworking. Collectors, including museums, have been big fans of ancient Iranian swords since 1928, when a large cache of Iron Age weapons was discovered in the northwestern province of Luristan. And as everyone scrambled to get their own genuine article, forgeries filtered into the market. But it can actually be tough to analyze fully metal objects. You generally don't want to use a technique that can damage them just in case they are real, and something like X-rays isn't gonna work because metal just lights up solid white. So the 8 swords intercepted in the UK were perfect candidates for a new type of imaging called neutron tomography. Neutrons, as you probably know, are neutrally charged particles normally found at the centers of atoms along with protons. But if you got the right equipment, like they have at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory in Oxfordshire, you can create a beam of individual neutrons. Or more specifically, brief pulses of neutrons to reduce the risk for your important artifacts. When the neutrons hit the sword, they create gamma rays. Those are basically the same as X-rays, but with a shorter wavelength and more energy. Assuming that you have a way to capture those gamma rays, you can create a map of both the sword's surface and its interior, including details on what different parts of it are made of. So scientists were able to ask what parts of these swords were iron and what parts were bronze and what parts were glue. As it turns out, there was quite a bit of glue. There was also evidence of modern drilling, including holes and, in one sword, fragments of a drill bit. So unfortunately, these 8 swords were not from that bronze to Iron Age transition. Instead, it looks like forgers took the blades of ancient bronze swords and the hilts of iron swords and put them together for profit. The resulting Frankenstein swords we have now are a lot less useful for understanding ancient sword design. For now, the collection is on display at the British Museum, and they promise that they will repatriate them to Iran when they're done. We're watching you, British Museum. You better do that. And I guess they'll be done when they say they are. Very British.